Hello friends, welcome back to our channel. So in the previous session we have discussed about the copy and the view functions in NumPy, and in today's session we'll go with the some more functions in NumPy module. So that is how to create an array and how to convert into the required data type. Okay, so in that category we are having around three functions which can be creating an array with the existing data. That means already some data will be there and we will convert that data into n dimensional array of required data type, right? So in this session we'll see those type of functions. So there are mainly three functions for that one. So arrays with existing data. So already the data should be there, and from the data we will convert the array with the required data type. So the first one is as array function, and in this function it will convert the given data or a given input into the required data type. So we have to specify the required data type and it will convert into the required data type, right? So it will take the three arguments. The first one is the input. So the second one is the data type. The second one is the data type. That means we have to specify the data type which we require. And the third one is the order which we want to save. Okay, in which format the data, the array should be changed. So this can be either list or a tuple or any combination. Okay, so whatever the thing, any combination it will be considered. And this is the data type. So we have to specify the data type, either it may be integer or some bytes, okay, string bytes, or it can be a float, right? So we have to specify the data type, and this order is the row major order and column major order. Okay, so here if we specify capital C in inverted quotations, the complete input will be converted into n dimensional array with the given data type in a row major order. Okay, and if the column major we require, we have to specify capital F. So capital C for row major order, capital F for column major order. So we have to specify during the execution of this particular function, right? So let us take an example. Some L is equal to, I'm taking some 10, 20 and 30. So I am converting this into array. Okay, so what is the difference between a list and array? So if it is an array, we'll get the content as 10 20 30. So you can know the difference. So if it is a list, this is the multiple elements, with these elements will be separated with the comma. If it is array, it is also having a multiple elements, it is differentiated with the help of space. Okay, so this is the array, this is the list, not both are not equal, right? So we are converting this input into the required data type with a given order, right? So I will give, so as we have discussed earlier, all the functions should be called with the help of the module name. So here let us take import, we can also give some alias name, okay, import numpy as some np, okay, np is the alias name. So we have to call this function with the help of alias name np dot as array. Here we have to give the input, so l, I will give l as input, and data type. So here we are having the data type integer, so this is the integer. If I want to change it into float, here I have to specify float as the data type, and order, the third argument, that can be either C or F by default. So this is an optional thing, this is an optional thing. So if you use the only this one, by default it will consider as a row major order. So what is the difference between row major and a column major? So here you can observe, if you consider a multi-dimensional array, okay, see, I'm giving a two-dimensional array. So this implies, so two dimensions, and in each dimension we are having a three elements, right? So if we are considering this row major order, so row major order, we'll get the result as, so 10, so first we will fill with all the row elements, then the next row. So 20, 30, 40, 50 and 60. This is a row major order. Okay, if it is a column major order, it will fill in with the help of columns, right? So 10 and the column wise, so 40. Next 20, 50, 30 and 60. So this is the column major order and this is the row major order, right? So in order to convert this, in order to change the order, we have to specify the third parameter, that is order. So if you are not specifying here, then by default it will be taking as a row major order, right? So here if I give this F, automatically the data will be in column major order. So one thing, this can be applied for the multi-dimensional arrays. So if it is a single dimension, no problem, only one row will be there, so only one row and one column, so one row will be there, and there will be not much change for this one. So the major difference and how we can identify this column major order is, so if you implement this multi-dimensional, so you will get the, you will feel the difference. So how the column major order will be displayed and how the elements will be displayed in the row major order. So don't worry, I will show you the execution. So I will execute both the row major and a column major in the interpreter. So there is a function called nditer. nditer. So if you use this function, we can know this column major order and row major order. So I will show you while during the execution of these functions, right? So this is how we can convert any input to the data type, the given data type with the order, right? So I will show you this one in the interpreter. We'll move with the next function. See, next function, the next function is from buffer. From buffer, that's also same thing, from buffer. So here also it will be having the four parameters. One is a buffer, so this is an existing data. Okay, the next one is a d type, that is a data type, and the third argument is a count means the length of the returned array, that means a resultant array. So how much length of the array should be returned. Okay, here we can restrict the data length. And then offset means the position, the position from where we have to consider the creating the array. So this function will create an array, okay, with a given data type of given length from given position. From given position. So here this will create an array with a given data type. So the array will be created for the given buffer of data. So data will be in buffer, right? So array will be created with a given data type. So this will be given by the user. Okay, so required data type. And next count, so of given length, so here we can restrict the length of the data. And from the given position, here we can specify the position from where we require the data. Okay, so this is also the implementation part. I will show you on the interpreter. So I will give you an example. So I am taking some byte string. Okay, some byte string, some s is equal to. So if it is a byte string, we have to prefix the letter small b with the given string. See, if I will go with this one, so welcome. So I am giving s is equal to b welcome. So whenever you are using b as a prefix, this will be considered as a byte, not as a string. It will be considered as a byte, not as a string. So byte means it will be considered as an ASCII values. Okay, completely considered as an ASCII values. So instead of saving in a character, it will save with the help of a ASCII values, right? So this is the byte string. And here, see, I just want to take this one. So from buffer, I will show you this one. From buffer, so here buffer is nothing but some s, so byte string. And d type, so I will not change this one. So s1 is the d type for the byte string. And then count, so by default by default, count will be minus 1. If count is minus 1, the complete string will be considered. The length will be the complete string. Okay, the complete data. Okay, the complete data. And offset. The offset will be 0. By default, the offset will be 0. That means the position will be at the starting position. See, here you can observe some count is equal to some minus 1, offset is equal to 0. So it will return an array as B W B E B L B C B O B M B E. So this is the result for this function, right? So welcome, complete elements will be printed because here we are giving some count is equal to minus 1. By default it will be minus 1. So if you are not giving these two parameters, by default it will be considered as a minus 1 and here it will be considered as a 0, right? So if you specify here some around 3, the count will be only 3. See, 1, so 3 and offset 0, 3 and offset 0. So that means first it will consider from the offset 0. Offset 0 means 0th index. So B W B E B L. So this is the output of this one, because here the we are restricting the count. Okay, we are restricting the count to 3 characters or 3 elements. So 3 elements will be given, right? So this is the array. And if you are giving here offset as some 3, offset as some 3, so consider here 0, 1, 2, 3. So from this position 3 elements will be printed. See, from this position, right, some B, C, B, O, B, M. So this is the output for the given function if count is 3 and offset is 3. Offset is 3, right? So offset means the starting position from where we have to extract, and count is the length of the returned array or resultant array, the length of the resultant array, how much length it should be, right? So this is how we can use this from buffer. Okay, from buffer. Now we'll go with the third one, the last function. So that is the last function is also very similar, that is from iter. From iter, the name itself indicates iter means iterables. Iterables means list or a tuple or any iterable sequence can be considered as a iter. So it will take that iterable statements and it will convert into an array with the given count. From iter, the first parameter is a iterable sequence. The second parameter is a data type, and the third parameter is a count. Right. So iterable can be either list or a tuple or any other sequence, right? So data type can be some integer or a float or any string, okay, whatever it may be. And count can be the resultant, the length of the resultant, okay, the length of returned array or a resultant array. So whatever the array it was returning, that array length will be count. And here the by default the count will be minus 1. So here, coming to this one, so if you consider some list or you can consider some tuple, okay, some t is equal to some 10, 20 and 30, 3 elements. So we can convert it to this array. So from iter function, first one iterable, so we have, I'll pass t as an argument. So first one, then data type, I just want to convert it into float, so I will just convert into float. I will write here float. And so count, so count is equal to minus 1. By default it will be minus 1, so I am also giving as a minus 1. So the resultant array, so here we have to call this function with the help of NumPy. Okay, we have to call this function with the help of NumPy. So np, I have given the alias name np. So np dot from iter t data type and count. So the resultant array will be 10 dot, 20 dot, 30 dot. Okay, because here dot means some float, precision, right? So the integer value will be converted into a float. Okay, or simply you can say s is equal to, so 10, 20 and 30, or simply we can say is a 1, 2, 3. Okay, 1, 2, 3. So if you consider this as a string, so you will get some 1, 2 and 3. That complete data will be converted into some string data type. Okay, so this is how we can pass the iterable sequence and we can get the required data type without given count. So here if you are giving count as 2, if you are giving the count as 2, the resultant will be 10 dot and 20 dot. That's it. The resultant will be 10 dot and 20 dot. 10 point and 20 point. Right? So this is how we can create an array from the existing data. These three functions will be used to create an array with the existing data. So in all these three functions, we are giving the existing data and we are converting into the required type of data with the, some sort of parameters like count and offset. Right? So hope you understood. Three functions we have studied, that is as array, then from buffer and from iter, the three functions. Right, so don't worry, so I will show you the execution of all these three functions in the interpreter. So let us move on to the interpreter. So just now we have seen various functions to create n-dimensional array in the required data type with the existing data. So in that we have seen three functions, that is as array, from buffer and from iter. So we'll see how to execute these functions and how the working of these functions. So I'm taking the Jupyter notebook and I will execute the things here. So in the Jupyter notebook, so first we need to import the NumPy. So we can give an alias name or directly we can call those functions with the help of the module name. So here I will give the alias name import NumPy as np, right? Now we'll create one array, a normal array with some data. So I will give some data, some a is equal to np dot array of, so here I'm passing some data, right? So here I'm passing some data. You can print this a so that we'll get the array, right? So now we'll create the n-dimensional array with the required data type. So for that we can use this as array function. So here I will store that in one result is equal to some np dot as array of first argument. So it will take three arguments. First one is the input, so here I am giving a as an input, and the second one is the data type, the required data type we have to give, so I will convert it into float. So and the third one is the order, so here we can pass the order, so either we require to store in a row wise order or a major wise order. So for C it is a row major order, and for F it is a column major order. So I am giving a row major order itself. Yeah, if you print this one, we'll get the result as a single array. Okay, right. So this is how we can use this as array. So here you can observe that 10 point, 20 point, 30 point, 40 point. So the integer has been converted into the a float. And now we'll see how this order will be working. So we'll consider some multidimensional array. So I will take some b is equal to np dot array of, I will take some multi dimension 10, 20, 30 and 2 dimension 40, 50 and 60, right? So if I print b, we will get the multi dimensional array. You can observe here, so 2 dimensions and in each dimension we are having the 3 elements, right? Now we will convert this one, right? So I will convert this one, result 1 is equal to, so we'll convert into column major order. Column major order means we have to consider the same function as array, and here we have to consider the input. So I am considering b as input and d type. So I don't want to change the input here. I will keep the same. So I will keep it integer. And the third one is nothing but an order, and I just want to save this in column major. So I have to mention here f instead of c. we have to mention here F. So by default it will be C, that means a row major order. And we, if we require to change it into column major, we have to convert into F. So I have converted. And if you print result 1, you will not observe any change. Okay. Sorry. Yes. Okay. Name as array. So here I just given as array. We have to call it with a numpy function. I just forgot it. So it given error. Okay. Numpy dot array. Right. See. Now we'll. Okay. Okay. So here. See. We have given some alias name, right? We have given alias name and we have, right. See, by using the alias name, so I have created some array with column major and it was assigned to result 1. If I print this result 1, we'll get the same result. There will be no differentiation between this row order or a major order. If you print all the elements with the help of nd iter, okay. So there is a function to print all the elements in a single dimension. If you print the elements in a single dimension, you can observe that whether they are occupying the row major order or a column major order. So we'll check it out. For I in np dot nd iter, so nd iter function is used to print everything in a single dimension. So here you will give the resultant, so result 1 and print I. If I print I, we'll get C. You can observe. So 10, 20, 30, 40, 50, 60. So we have given here. So you can observe here we have given order as F. That means a column major order, and that is saved in result 1. So if I am printing each and every element by using nd iter function, we are getting C. Column major. So 10, next 40 will be printed. 20 and next 50 will be printed. 30 and next 60 will be printed. So this is called the column major order. Now we'll see the same thing in a row major order also. So if you observe here, I am taking it as a result 2, np.array, and the same thing, I am not changing anything, but just I am changing the order into a row major order. So if you use the same thing, what was the result? How this data is? So you can observe here 10, 20, 30, 40, 50, 60. So that's what we are having this. So I will print here, print result 2. So you can observe 10, 20, 30, 40, 50, 60. That is the row major order. Row major order. So by default, this order will be row major order. Alright. So this is how we can use this as array function. So three parameters will be taken. The first one is the input, the second one is the data type, and the third one is the order which we need to save, right? The input can be not only the list, we can also consider the tuples or any combination of tuples and list, right? So we'll move on to the next function, that is a from buffer. Here we have to consider one buffer, and we'll take that buffer as an input, and the remaining we'll see the syntaxes also. So I will consider some s is equal to, so I will take b followed by the string. B followed by the string. Hello. Welcome to Python. Right. So the purpose of using B as a prefix to the string that implies, so these data will be saved in terms of bytes, not as a strings. So this H will not be considered as a string. This H will be considered as a byte. That means ASCII value. Right. So for representing the string in terms of bytes, we'll use the B as a prefix. So I'm using this B as a prefix right now. So we'll use the same thing. So some C is equal to the same. We have to call with the alias name or a NumPy module, np from buffer. From buffer, we have to give the buffer name. So here S is the buffer. And the second one is the data type which we need to convert. I will not give anything. I will just pass it to a string, comma. And the third one is a count. So which will display the length of the string. I mean, how much count of data should be
printed on the screen. So by default it will be minus one, so that everything, all the data will be printed on the screen. So by default we'll give minus one. And next one is the offset, from where we have to start printing the data. So by default the offset will also be zero. That means the position is zero. It will indicate the starting position of the data to be printed. Right. See, I will execute this one. So if you print C, we'll get the result. See, you can observe. So here the string, the prefix for every string, there is a B called a B letter. So that implies this is a byte. It will be stored in terms of a byte, not in terms of a string. Right. See, you can observe here. So everything will be printed. Everything will be printed because here we are giving count as minus one. Minus one means everything will be printed. And offset zero means from the zeroth position it will be printed. Now we'll change this one and we'll check. So I will change this one. See, count, I will change. I will give some 10. So if you press enter, so if you print C, you can observe only the 10 characters will be printed. That means a 10 elements will be printed, right? So even the space is also counted as a character. Space will be also having some ASCII value. So space will be also considered as a byte. Okay, byte. So hope you understood this one. So this one, so C, here we are giving count as 10, so only the 10 count will be printed. Okay, so length of the returned array, that means this count means the length of the returned array. So length of the array, that is going to be printed. And offset is starting index, so starting function, right? So we'll change the that one also, offset as some 6. I will print C here itself. So if you press enter, see, so from welcome onwards it was printed, because offset is 6, the starting position, from the starting position we are considering the starting position as a 6. So from the 6 itself it was going to print the return array, right? So this is how we can use this from buffer. So this from buffer means we have to consider the input and the data type which we need to change, and also the count, that means the length of the returned array, and the offset, the beginning length, the starting length of the this thing, right? Okay, now we'll move with the third one, that is a from iter. Here also the same thing. So here it the input will be some iterations, some iterables. Iterables means like a list or a tuple, right? So I will consider some list is equal to, so I will consider some list 10, 20, 30, 40, 50. So I'm considering some list, and here I'm some d is equal to np dot from iter, the third function from iter. So here I'm passing the first one as a iterable statement. Here iterable statement is a list, comma, we can change the data type. So d type is equal to, we can change it to float or a string or any data type. And here also we can go with the count. Count is equal to minus one means the complete data will be printed, right? So we'll print that same function, I mean same this one. So we'll get 10 dot, 20 dot, 30 dot, 40 dot, and a 50 dot. This is an array. So if you change this one, see, if you change the same thing, byte data, bytes of data, so we'll get same thing. See, you can observe B. So S1 is nothing but a bytes, one byte data. Okay, one byte data. So this is how we can convert any data type to the required data type. And here we can change the count. The change the count as some 2. So we'll get only the two values, 10 dot, 2 dot. Okay. So here we are not having the third one, that is the offset. So we are the fourth parameter, that is the offset. So here also we are having only three parameters. One is the iterable, data type, and the count. Right. So hope you understood. So these are the functions mainly used to create an array, nd array in NumPy with the existing data. So for all these three functions we are considering the existing data. So from that existing data we are converting into the required data type, and we are just extracting the required portion of the data by using the count or offset. Right. So this is how we can implement these three functions, right? So hope you understood this one, and if you are having any doubts regarding these three functions feel free to post your doubts in the comment section, so that definitely I will try to clarify all your doubts. And if you really understood my session, like my session, share my session with your friends, and don't forget to subscribe to our channel. So thanks for watching. Thank you very much.